Is it moving?
Slide is moving, yeah.
Okay. So, definition, IgG for cholangiopathy is characterized by obstruction of large scale-sized bile ducts, and it is characterized by scleriform fibrosis, infiltration by positive plasma cells, obliterative phlebitis of the affected segment, and elevation of serum IgG4. There are so many synonyms, but the one closely associated with this IgG4 associated sclerosing cholangitis is the most often used synonym. Because it is not in this mode, I am trying to change it. Okay. So what are the clinical features? The clinical feature of IgG4 cholangiopathy is just like any other obstructive jaundice. This character and the involvement is either extrahepatic or intrahepatic duct system or even both systems. Majority of cases of IgG4 associated cholangiopathy is seen along with autoimmune pancreatitis. That's it. In 90% of the cases of IgG4 cholangiopathy is associated with autoimmune pancreatitis. This patient also may have weight loss and new onset of diabetes. Sometimes these cases are detected when we work up extrahepatic organ involvement like lacrimal and salivary gland or a retroperitoneal disease, and the biliary involvement is incidentally detected. The disease is generally seen in older people, usually above the age of 60, and more often in males. Sometimes this disease can produce a pseudo-tumor appearance, in which case we'll have lot of confusion as whether it is a cholangiocarcinoma. And from the beginning itself, I want to say that it is not associated with the cholangiocarcinoma as a sequelae, but it can be always an immediate differential diagnosis, IgG4 cholangiopathy. So we go to the clinical picture. According to the site of involvement of the ductal system, biliary ductal system, it is divided into four different types. The type one is seen here, that the lower part of the common bile duct is involved, and it's seen in 64%, that means almost 2/3 of the case. Type 2 has two divisions, A and B. Well, A, the hilum is involved and other interlobular ducts are involved, while in B, it is much more diffuse involvement as you get in sclerosing cholangitis. It's approximately 13% of the entire spectrum. Type 3, along with the lower involvement, there will be hilar involvement. Of course, in this case, there will be doubts as to whether it is some other disease. And type 4 is classical hilar involvement, where we think that it could also be a hilar carcinoma. So the prevalence is 64% in type 1, that is almost 2/3, and the remaining around 10% each for all the other three. Now, we'll straight away go to the imaging. The imaging, generally, we have to do a non-invasive imaging, and it will show multifocal stricture with mild proximal dilatation despite a long stricture. And if there is an associated autoimmune pancreatitis, there could be a long stricture, especially of the lower CPD. And in the case of pancreas, you don't find an upstream dilatation, which is usually common in the case of a CF pancreas. And there can be multifocal strictures as well. If you do EUS, the diffuse hypercoagulant pancreatic enlargement, because why pancreas is shown here is because there is a strong association with the autoimmune pancreatitis. Then concentric bile duct wall thickening, that is, and it will have three layer appearance, that is regular thickening with a hypoechoic intermediate layer and a hyperechoic outer and inner layer. So you'll see three layers of the CPD which is thickened. So this is, can be easily seen on a cross-section on an EUS. If you have facilities to do intraductal ultrasound, thickening of the bile duct wall more than 0.8 millimeter in a non-stenotic bile segment, and again concentric wall thickening with a smooth configuration of the outermost layer and a smooth luminal surface. This is an EUS which shows the thickening of the bile duct wall, and this CT actually shows the bile duct in the, must be right hepatic, right branch of the right hepatic duct, and this also shows thickening. This is another area which shows the thickening, and this one MRCP look exactly like as you find in a Kailar Palangia carcinoma, which form the differential diagnosis. These are associated phenomena when you do a CT. If there is associated retroperitoneal fibrosis, we can see this in the retroperitoneum around the thickened area around the aorta, abdominal aorta. Of course, these are actually shown to show the difference between PSC, because in PSC, it can affect extrahepatic, intrahepatic system. There can be multiple picture, but the classic picture is that bleeding. That bleeding appearance is classic of PSC, which is not seen in any other condition. This is a case where there's an extensive small duct involvement, almost like a pruned one. And here we can find a bleeding as well as some outpouching of the ductal system, which is, this is outpouching, which is typical of primary sclerosing cholangitis. Why I showed the picture of primary sclerosing cholangitis is because that is the immediate differential diagnosis. Because some of the clinical pictures overlap, the radiology pictures overlap, etc. This is a case of autoimmune cholangiopathy with the classic involvement of the hilum as well as the lower end of the cilia. Now, another feature by which you diagnose autoimmune IgG for autoimmune disease is by the level of serum IgG4. The normal value is considered up to 140. There is mild difference between Japanese. They say 135, but generally accepted is 140. If the values are above 250 per deciliter, the sensitivity is around 67-89%, and specificity is 95%. In type 1 and type 2, where we have lesser doubts of cholangiocarcinoma, even a value above 140 can be considered important. But in type 2 and 3, or in rather, whenever there's a doubt where there's an underlying neoplasm, especially of the biliary tree, a higher value would be better if we have no other features, no other histology, etc., are not there. Then remember that around 10% of cases, this high value of IgG4 may not be there. So around 10% IgG negative autoimmune cholangiopathy can occur. And also remember that in PSC, there can be IgG4 elevation and is seen up to 23% of cases also. So there can be a situation where you can have IgG4 negative cholangiopathy, which is of this type, and there can be IgG for positive in a PSC where there are all the features. Now, how to confirm? Of course, the best way is to confirm is to have a tissue diagnosis. And of course, it is to exclude the malignancy. As I told multiple times, that neoplasm is in the immediate differential diagnosis. So people do ambulatory biopsy. If the lower end of CBD is affected on imaging, you can do ambulatory biopsy. And especially also if the patient has got a pancreatic ductal involvement, especially in the head region. Okay, it is very simple, easy to do, can be done in almost all institutions where there's an endoscope and an ordinary histopathology followed by an immunohistochemistry for IgG for cells will be enough. Then if you have facilities, we can do FNA of the pancreas, especially when there is a mass-like lesion, or FNA of the thickened bile duct also can be done. Cholangioscopic biopsies are also possible. Sometimes there may be small nodular tumor-like lesions in this situation. It can be taken biopsy. Normally, we don't do biopsy, liver biopsy for IgG for cholangiopathy because it's a disease affecting major and intermediate ducts, not the small ductules as you find in PBC. But if there's a strong suspicion of overlap between PBC and small duct PSC, then we may have to do a liver biopsy also. And then we can stain for IgG for cells and find out whether there is it's an overlap with IgG4. A typical histology of IgG4 disease will have dense plasma, lymphoplasma cell infiltration. IgG4 positive cells are more than 10 hyperbole field. But surgical specimen, they always insist for more than 50 hyperbole field, unlike biopsy specimens. The other findings are storiform fibrosis and obliterated plebitis of the affected area. Interestingly, the bile ductular epithelium is not affected. So the bile ducts are affected from the externally, not from the bile ductular mucosal side or the epithelial side. Peritumoral pancreatic tissue may have IgG4 cells in 10% of CA pancreas. That's why when receptor specimens, they want more than 50 IgG4 cells per hyperbole field to say that IgG4 disease. This is a histopathology of IgG4 disease. So this is a classic story from fibrosis, extensive fibrosis in a rounded fashion. And here, of course, is a special staining with the IgG4, showing the IgG4 positive cells. This is the ampulla, which can be slightly edematous, and biopsy showing. So this slide shows that the prevalence of positivity on a bile duct is around 52%. Ampulla varies between 50 to 80%, and a liver biopsy maximum up to 60%. But specificity is extremely high. So if you find IgG4 in these areas, the specificity is very high. Now, this is a diagnostic criteria of, there are two criteria now, the Mayo's ISOT criteria and the Japanese Pancreatic Society criteria. Essentially, these are similar, except for mild differences. So it is basically imaging of the bile duct, then serology, extent of other organ involvement, histology, response to steroids. According to these criteria, it is said. So basically, there's a mild difference in the imaging findings between the Mayo and the Japanese. And extra organ involvement, renal lesions are considered for a Mayo, but it is not considered for the Japanese. And the criteria are given, like a combination of various criteria are there. So what are the differential diagnosis? The immediate differential diagnosis, of course, primary sclerosing cholangitis. And whenever we consider primary sclerosing cholangitis, we should also entertain secondary sclerosing cholangitis due to so many other etiology. Primary biliary cholangitis or PBC. Follicular cholangiopathy, a very rare condition. Cholangiocarcinoma, pancreatic head carcinoma, chronic pancreatitis with stricture of the lower end of CBD. And in our country, of course, TB stricture of the biliary tree. Now, of course, this, according to the different types, for example, if we have a lesion of the type 1 and the lower end of CBD is affected, what we have to consider are 1, cholangiocarcinoma, 2, pancreatic head carcinoma. If the lesions are affecting both lower part and the hilar or beyond that, then the differential diagnosis include sclerosing cholangitis and both 2 and B. If it is type 3, again, we have to consider sclerosing cholangitis, and of course, we can also consider cholangiocarcinoma. Type 4, cholangiocarcinoma will be the immediate differential diagnosis. Okay, now according to the type of involvement of the site, you can plan further investigation, whether it is indirect ultrasound, EOS, FNA, etc. Now, how will you differentiate PSC from IgG for sclerosing cholangitis? PSC generally occurs below 40 years, IgG for beyond 60 years. May distribution, of course, predominantly male in the case of IgG4. Sometimes up to 35% females can be affected in PSC. A background of IBD is seen in a large percentage of patients with sclerosing cholangitis, which is not there in IgG4 disease. Autoimmune pancreatitis, almost 90% in case of IgG4 disease. Clinical presentation in early stages, PSC can be asymptomatic, but in IgG4, by and large, these patients are symptomatic, except a few percentage where they may remain asymptomatic. CT and MRI, multifocal short strictures alternating with circular dilatation and beaded appearance, longer segments. So here in IgG4, longer segments, and there can be complete circumferential thickening. Histology, obliterated cholangitis. Here it is toriform fibrosis, lymphoplasmacytic infiltration, and IgG4 cells. In PSC, IgG4 elevation is rare. Of course, it can occur in 10% of cases where there is an overlap. And it is classic in the case of IgG4 disease, where it is found in 90% of cases. This is an old slide which says 70%. Treatment. There is no response to steroids, unlike in the case of IgG4, where there is a dramatic response to steroids in almost all cases, but there is no such response to steroids. Even with the UDCA, the treatment response of PSC is not very adequate. So there is another scoring system where people consider the age, the other organ involvement, beaded appearance of biliary tree, and then classified into probable PSC, indicating diagnostic steroid probable IgG4. So this is a diagnostic criteria. Now, secondary sclerosing cholangitis can occur due to trauma, surgery, ischemia, chemical injury to bile ducts, direct chemotherapy, parasitic disease, and radiation injury. All those will have to be kept in mind. Primary biliary cirrhosis, of course, is rare. Female, Caucasian, insidious onset, and jaundice is late, whereas jaundice is one of the early manifestations of IgG for cholangiopathy. And the stricture, like you find in IgG for cholangiopathy, is not seen. And some pruning of the intrahepatic biliary tree is seen in advanced case of primary biliary cirrhosis. The classic stricture, bleeding, other things are negative. And AMA is positive, and liver biopsy is classic. Cholangiocarcinoma affecting the hilar region or the common hepatic duct or common bile duct can mimic IgG for cholangiopathy. This patient, of course, pain, anorexia, weight loss, hepatomegaly will be dominant manifestation, rapid progression, and imaging may help us. And if we have a mass lesion, we can take FNA or FNAC from the lesion. But if it is operable, we never go for it, and we generally suggest surgery. Of course, CA19-9 could be elevated. And of course, if IgG4 is elevated, then we have to consider IgG4 disease. And therefore, if IgG4 is normal in 90%, a small 10%, even in cholangiocarcinoma, IgG4 may be marginally elevated. And of course, we don't give steroids if we have got a strong suspicion of cholangiocarcinoma. Only if you have got a strong suspicion of IgG4 disease, we give steroids for a therapeutic trial. Carcinoma hepatopancreas. In a patient with autoimmune pancreatitis, the two types of involvement can occur. One is diffuse enlargement of the pancreas, and second is a focal disease of the head of pancreas. A focal disease of the head of pancreas very often confuses us between a carcinoma head of the pancreas producing obstructive jaundice. So the serum IgG for elevation, FNA look for IgG for cells, and elevation of CA19-9 in the case of CA pancreas, and of course, response to steroids when we have a strong doubt of IgG4 disease. So, diagnostic approach. 90% of IgG4 associated cholangitis is associated with autoimmune pancreatitis. So, closely image the pancreas, look for pancreatic involvement, and if the pancreatic involvement shows IgG4 cells on FNA, I think our diagnosis is certain. But isolated IgG4 cholangiopathy is a real issue where our differentials are TSC, cholangiocarcinoma, etc. If the serum IgG4 are elevated, only beyond 250 level, we can be sure. If it is between 140 and 250, we have to look for other methods of diagnosis. So, we have different algorithms available, and basically diffuse or segmental stenosis of the bile duct with the wall thickness, elevation of serum IgG4. It is associated with autoimmune pancreatitis or other IgG4 disease. Always we can try steroid therapy. And then if it's predominantly a bile duct involvement, we have to look at what type, type 1, type 2, and type 3. Type 1 also is generally associated with the pancreatic involvement. Type 2, type 3, and 4, one may have to be very careful, and then we have to make all steps to rule out carcinoma, especially cholangiocarcinoma, and rarely sclerosing cholangitis. These are the various. This again, if it is type 1, how will you do? How will you do bile duct biopsy and other things and like that? So, type 2, again, you have got an algorithm. Type 3 and 4 also, you have got an algorithm. So, summary, IgG for cholangiopathy is very often associated with autoimmune pancreatitis in around 90% of cases. Most of these patients present with obstructive jaundice, and it mimics carcinoma head of pancreas and cholangiocarcinoma. Has to be differentiated from PSC. Serum IgG4 levels elevated more than 300. It is very useful, but generally it may not be that well. Biopsy of the ampulla or bile duct or pancreatic mass is helpful. More than 10 IgG4 cells per hypofield in FNA is diagnostic, and response to steroid is dramatic. Okay, ma'am, this is the reference, a role of endoscopic procedures in the diagnosis of IgG4 related pancreatic disease. This is 2020. And the other one is a Journal of Hepatobiliary Pancreatic Science 2019. It actually gives a very detailed clinical practice guideline for IgG4 related sclerosing cholangitis. I think almost all your doubts will be cleared if you read this article. Okay, that's the end of my presentation. Thank you. Thank you for the patient listening.
Dr. Swati?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr.
Thank you so much for that wonderful talk, sir. Very comprehensive, very well-covered talk, sir.
Dr. Mala, do you have any questions? One or two questions? We can just take up brain, Mala. Or should we take up the case discussion and then probably take a call? No?
Yes, ma'am.
That may be better.
Can we go ahead with the case discussion, ma'am, and finally we can discuss it with the case?
Okay, so so we'll request Coimbatore Medical College to come in. Dr. Arul Selvan. Dr. Arul? Sir is there, Shania?
Sir
is joining?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, just ask him to join.
Okay.
So we'll have a case discussion. Dr. Varghese and Dr. Prem, Dr. Hema, all of you please interact. It is more of a teaching session. So the candidate is from Coimbatore Medical College. Arul is around. So Coimbatore Medical College had its gastroenterology, I think, started sometime. The very first gastroenterologist was T.S. Chandrasekhar. I think they started the department sometime around 1986 or 88. And I was there for 2.5 years. And now they have again gastroenterology course, which is ongoing. So without wasting much time, Dr. Shadi can start your presentation. Dr. Varghese and Dr. Prem will be taking over. We request all the non-participating people to please mute your videos. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, Dr. Varghese and you can start.
Respected professors, I would like to thank Dr. Jayanti Madam and my HOD, Dr. Devishandar sir, Arul Selvan sir, for helping me with the presentation.
Yeah, Ravi Shankar is the head of the department, no?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So he was my assistant professor when I was in Coimbatore Medical College. So on behalf of all of us, we welcome Dr. Ravi Shankar and wish him all best wishes. Okay, start off.
Presenting Mr. Bhaskar, 25-year-old male, who is coming from Krishnagiri, presented with chief complaints of yellowish discoloration of eyes and urine from February 2019, pruritus, abdominal discomfort and fatigue from July 2019, and he had a history of alternative system of medicine intake in January 2021.
Continue.
A history of presenting complaints. He had insidious onset and progressive increase in the intensity of jaundice. He initially noted yellowish discoloration of eyes and urine, which deepened in intensity over the years, and there is no history of waxing or waning history. It was associated with the intense pruritus 6 months later, which was present both day and night, which was disturbing him from the sleep. And also it was associated, because of severe itching, he also developed the excoriation of the skin along with the hyperpigmentation. Initially, he had some relief after application of some external emollients. It was not associated with any prodromata like fever, anorexia, and there was no history of any long-term medication. He is a teetotaler. He also had history of abdominal discomfort, which was a dragging pain, mostly in the right upper quadrant. And also, he had history of alternative medicine intake. He had a handful of substances taken 15 days back on a 2 CK.
Yeah, next slide is again history. What's your next slide?
Yes, ma'am, history.
Let's continue. Then we'll discuss.
There is no associated catch during deep inspiration, no history of breathlessness, no history of any noticeable lump. He had also had a generalized fatigability and apnea. Vomiting is only a routine activity with a performance status of 2. There is no history of palpitation, testing, or cough. No history of abnormal bowel movements. His stools, no history of pale color stool, no blood or mucus in stool. Urine output is not normal.
Dr. LVK, I think you're around.
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah.
Yeah. You can just take up some questions here.
this patient has been having some cholestatic symptoms from 2019.
Yes.
Now he has presented with deep jaundice and severe pruritus, which has disturbed his life.
Yes.
In this 2 years, it's almost 2 years since it's developed.
Yes, sir.
When was the CAM taken? Initially, he was intermittently on active on CAM.
No, sir. He had only one episode of alternative medicine intake. That was recently. And he had taken it twice between 2 weeks interval.
So in these 2 years, was he intermittently going to the hospital and getting medications, or it was only CAM?
Yes, sir. He was going to a local hospital and getting a medication for something, but he was not on any regular follow-up or any investigation or any. This is not available to the patient, sir.
Was there any waxing and waning of jaundice?
No vaccine or jaundice as per patient's history.
For about 20 months, it's been going on progressive jaundice.
Yes, sir.
Decompensated anytime?
No, sir. No history of no decompensation. No history.
No ascites.
No ascites.
Polyuria. No encephalopathy.
No, sir. No history.
Has he lost weight?
He's not complaining of any loss of weight, sir. He's not having any anorexia or significant loss of weight over a period of 2 years, as per his treatment.
So there was generalized fatigability in asthenia. Was it because that he was lack of sleep or was not able to eat well?
He's not complaining of anorexia, but because of the itching, he was having complaints of it.
He was not having any other drugs for seizures or anything of that sort. There was no other comorbid condition for which he was on long-term drugs.
No long-term drug, no other comorbidities for him, sir.
Why do you think the history of decompensation is important in this patient? Dr. NDK asked you about why is it important? Is it relevant?
Yes, ma'am. Patient is having progressive jaundice for the period of 2 years. So patient can have a history of decompensation and liver cell failure. So
what all conditions would you get a decompensation? Long-standing jaundice and decompensation. When would you get that?
Any history of chronic viral hepatitis?
Chronic viral hepatitis will not go for 2 years. No?
Any metabolic condition?
There is some problem with your mic. Okay, so when on do you expect your decompensation in a biliary cirrhosis? Long-standing biliary cirrhosis is one of the conditions when you can get a decompensation.
Okay. They do develop portal hypertension. Portal hypertension really drives them for a decompensation. Okay?
Yes.
It's important, she had a bleed, did he have an edema, did he have encephalopathy, or did he have a progressive abdominal distension? Okay.
Yes,
this jaundice, was it triggered by any infection or something 2 years back? Did he have some infection then triggered?
He's not having fever before the onset of jaundice. Sir, it was insidious and progressive jaundice. Now, it's the fever with any other infection prior to the
Okay.
Just move on. The next slide is also history taking.
Throughout the 2 years period, there was no quality abdominal pain or fever. No symptoms are received of any liver cell failure. There is no history of abdominal distension, pedal edema, bleeding tendency, altered sensation or any abnormal movements. No history of anorexia or weight loss. Intake has also been with no history of migraines, bleeding, diastasis, bone or joint, ulnar fractures.
Can you set your mic a little? I think either you're speaking too close to your mic or something is wrong. So when do you expect this? Intake has been good. There's no history of migraines. So when do you expect a nutritional deficiency in a patient with jaundice who's got cholestatic features? When should you start asking a question of nutritional deficiency?
A long-standing history of
how long? When do you start suspecting?
More than 6 months.
Yeah, 6 months is too late, but at the same time, it cannot be too early. Amongst all these, vitamin E is the last one to result in nutritional deficiency. So what you will get will be more of an A, B, and K. And maybe 3 months. Dr. LBK, but well, this is 3 months.
Yeah, it takes about 3 months.
3 months.
Any of the biliary problems, the portal hypertension can set in as early as 3 weeks. But your malabsorption and this thing can may take anywhere from 3 months to 6 months. Okay?
Yeah, roughly 3 months.
3 months is what you need. But portal hypertension can set in early.
No, just continue.
Just continue, madam.
His intake has also been good. Now his history of migraine, bleeding, diastasis, bone or joint pain or fractures present. Patient has been investigated in the local hospital, but no reports proper are not available. Coming to a past history.
Can you change the slide?
Patient has remained investigated until this presentation. He has been on medical supportive medication, but no details available.
Okay. So when you summarize this, initial diagnosis you can have.
There are 25-year-old male patient.
How old is he?
25-year-old.
Okay.
A 25-year-old male patient presented, he's a non-smoker and non-alcoholic. He's presenting with the painless progressive jaundice along with the pruritus, abdominal discomfort and fatigue over a period of 3 years without any features of decompensation or fat-soluble vitamin deficiencies.
There was no history of any abdominal pain, recurrent abdominal pain, isn't it?
Yes, sir. He had abdominal discomfort, constant.
So he basically got a cholestatic liver disease, which is going on 2 years, and he has not decompensated.
Yes, sir.
According to you, he's been eating well, and he has not lost weight or not developed anorexia. Yes. And he has had a CAM taken on 2 occasions in this last 2 years.
Yes, sir.
Am I right?
Yes, sir.
And was this and this jaundice was not preceded by any prodro or any other prolonged drug intake, isn't it? Supposing somebody has a seizure and been taking, you can always get a cholestatic jaundice.
One of the important history is biliary surgery.
Post cholestatic. Not any surgery.
No history of biliary surgery. No history of any biliary surgery.
Somebody has had a biliary surgery and has come with cholestatic jaundice. What will be the difference in presentation here? They do a biliary surgery. Why do they develop cholestatic jaundice when you have biliary surgery?
Any strictures, biliary strictures?
Yeah, when you have a biliary stricture due to surgery, apart from jaundice, what is the other thing they present with? Recurrent cholangitis. Recurrent cholangitis. They come with recurrent cholangitis. Recurrent cholangitis in a biliary stricture is not malignant. It's always benign. They come with that. Okay, that is all. So he has not had any cholangitis.
No cholangitis.
Abdominal pain. Okay?
Yes,
so the history of surgery is very important because sometimes in post-transplant situations also you can get, biliary stricture.
Okay.
So very important that history of surgery is important. One is post-cholecystectomy, complicated, uncomplicated. Surgery for gallbladder cancer important. Post-transplant in the present scenario, post-NDLT, donor, recipient, any of them can get. Okay.
This can happen, and, surgery. Yeah. Only other thing is, did he have any bleed in the early childhood?
In childhood history was also asymptomatic.
Yes, supposing somebody has had a child bleed at the age of 12 years, 13 years, 2 times bleed, and then now he has come with jaundice.
Any extrahepatic biliary obstruction?
Due to?
Rohan?
Due to any infection in the early childhood, umbilical sepsis.
Supposing somebody has had a bleed at the age of 8 years, 9 years, 12 years, the most common thing, and they have survived 25 years without edema, could be extrahepatic portal vein obstruction. In those situations, patient may have portal cavernomocholangiopathy, and they can come with a progressive jaundice. You need not be very symptomatic. They may get pain only when they develop a stone. So these are the few things you need to think of, because he's only 25 years old.
Okay. Yes.
Okay, madam.
And it could still be an EHP, you know, we do not know. Because
we don't know. Exactly. Because he has been totally asymptomatic, but I've been EHP.
Yeah.
So based on this, what will be your differentials before we go to your slide?
Varghese, anything? Any comments on the history?
No, I think a very detailed history has been presented. And
should we move on to the differentials? Welcome, Arul. So just complete the history and give your differentials.
Unmute, please. Arul, unmute.
Good afternoon, madam. Sorry, over net connectivity, madam. That's it.
No problem. I introduced you. Don't worry. Okay. Shall we continue?
Past history was more comorbidity, no history of similar episodes in the past, no endoscopic intervention, no abdominal surgery, no history of any blood transfusions or any chronic medical intake, no history of any TB or any history of ACP intake. Family history is a firstborn child of a third degree consanguineous marriage, no family history.
Why is the family history important? Why did you ask for family history?
Any Wilson disease, hemochromatosis, progressive familial intrahepatic cholestasis, etc., can have a family.
Wilson's will not go on for 2 years with progressive jaundice, hale and healthy. The moment patients with Wilson's develop progressive jaundice, and yes, he would not have survived for 2 years. Okay, he would not have survived this patient. Up with them. Going alone with jaundice in Wilson's for 2 years. No remission of jaundice and without decompensation is very, very uncommon. The moment the Wilson's will be asymptomatic, they can have intermittent elevation of asymptomatic transaminitis, they may have a mild fibrosis. The moment the jaundice comes, and once your Nazareth score goes up, then they don't survive long. So Wilson's is just out of this picture by sheer history that there is no, it can't be Wilson's. Okay?
Okay.
Hemochromatosis is too young to develop hemochromatosis, right?
Yes, sir.
Can it be brick?
No, let's go to the differential diagnosis. No, I think this is consanguinity is only one. Wilson.
Mainly I asked because of the family history, no? For the family history, I was asking for that reason. You consider one of those.
Families with prostatic diseases can be brick. It can be progressive familial cholestasis. All those things can be there. Okay, brick is possible. You can have PFIC3 as a family history.
Continue.
Personal history is unmarried, non-smoker, and a typical tailor. There is no history of any sexual exposure. Diet history is taking adequate in calories and proteins.
Okay.
Summarize, doctor.
25-year-old male patient who is a non-smoker and teetotaler present with painful progressive cholestatic jaundice with intense pruritus, abdominal discomfort and fatigue, absence of fever, colicky abdominal pain, and no sense of liver cell failure or no endoscopic intervention.
Can
you
go to the differential diagnosis on your summary? Okay, now this is first thing is it intrahepatic or extrahepatic?
Patient is not having any history of fever or abdominal pain or anything.
Intrahepatic or extrahepatic?
Most probably intrahepatic cause of cholestasis.
For the following reasons. Number one.
No history of fever present, sir. No history of any abdominal pain. No history of significant loss of weight. And history of alternative medicine in the
past. There is no history of any surgery in the past.
No surgery.
History of pain. And no extrahepatic obstruction can go on for 2 years. Even in patient who develop portal cavernoma cholangiopathy, we don't call it portal biliopathy anywhere, portal cavernoma thing, they can have intermittent jaundice going up and coming. So it's not be a progressive jaundice. Very uncommon for a patient with extrahepatic obstruction to go on painless for nearly 2 years.
And with no liver cell failure.
A patient who has got carcinoma head of pancreas, patient who has got a stricture, by 2 years they would have just decompensated if you are not intervening in these patients. So it means he's got intrahepatic cholestasis and seems to have a rather benign course, isn't it?
Yes.
2 years, he has not really this thing. 2 years, he has not to think. If it has been a PSC going on for, could have gone on for 2 years, or if it is anything else, it's a viral hepatitis or going on for a cholestasis due to Hep B or Hep C, they would have this thing. So it looks to have a very benign course. So based on that, so it looked like an intrahepatic cholestasis going on for 2 years, no decompensation, no bleed. So what are the possibilities for this patient?
He can have a CAM-induced liver dysfunction. Then
CAM has caused a liver dysfunction. And he has got only two.
Yes.
Two is the CAM, which he has taken after the onset of jaundice.
Yes, sir.
Line of taking cancer jaundice is much later. Okay.
Yes.
CAM has caused static jaundice going on for 2 years is very, very uncommon. Pain is decompensated. So it's very uncommon to go only with this thing. There may be something underlying cholestatic disorder and which CAM would have completely added on to the insult. Okay, that is a possibility. Just CAM alone is not a 25 years old, what will you think of? Look at the age.
Primary sclerosing cholangitis you can have. Autoimmune hepatitis.
No, if somebody has gone on like this, the first thing you will think is a benign recurrent cholangitis. Somebody has gone on like this, you know. Absolutely. You say there's no wasting, nothing. He's eating well. So what could be a trick? Okay?
Okay, sir.
Sign recurrent intrahepatic cholestasis. Number two?
Autoimmune hepatitis.
No, I think you go to your slide. No? I think you put your slide. You put your slide. No? Next slide you can put on. No, next slide. Next slide. Yeah. So, somebody has gone on like this, going on with intrahepatic cholestasis so long, 2 years, and absolutely well preserved, according to you. Okay, one could see. I think I would agree it could be a brick is a possibility and PFIC is a possibility. That is where your family history comes into play.
Yes.
One, two, or three. Okay. Drug-induced liver injury should be taking a drug for quite some time. I don't think idiopathic medicine will go on for a cholestasis for a long time. Little unlikely to go on for 2 years. I've seen going on for nearly 2 years.
Yes.
Then, what are the other intrahepatic?
Autoimmune hepatitis.
Autoimmune primary sclerosing cholangitis is an option. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Autoimmune hepatitis with an overlap. Okay. With an overlap. Plus autoimmune hepatitis or autoimmune cholangiopathy. Apart from PSC, you're going to have an autoimmune cholangiopathy. Then,
primary biliary
cholangitis, uncommon in this age group. It predominantly starts with pruritus and then go to jaundice. Nobody develops jaundice and go to it. So this will be basically a female patient, 40s, will come with pruritus, will have an alkaline phosphatase going up and then they go in for jaundice. Really presents with jaundice. Mm-hmm. The only time a primary biliary cirrhosis can come with the jaundice is when they have an overlap. They may have an autoimmune hepatitis or something with an overlap. So PVC with overlap is a problem, but it again is a male age.
Yes.
IgG4 related sclerosing cholangitis is a possibility, but honestly, I have not seen IgG4 SE going on for 2 years. 2 years, okay? 2 years. Then they put it as benign biliary stricture, unlikely because he has not had any intervention, he has not had any surgery. And as I told you, portal hypertensive, it is not called portal sclerosing cholangitis, it is called portal hypertensive sclerosing cholangitis. You mean, is it extrahepatic portal vein obstruction and portal biliopathy?
Yes.
Then it's called as portal cavernoma cholangitis. It's either called portal biliopathy or it is called as portal cavernoma cholangitis, PCC. That is what is called. So PCC is a possibility in a young age. He can be totally, as madam said, it can be totally asymptomatic. And all you need is that you put there, you will have a large spleen or something. That's why the history is important, that the bleed earlier, much earlier in life, is an important history and a clue. I have seen PCC coming with a progressive jaundice, then you will have it.
Yeah, I think among the intrahepatic, PFIC and PRIC are two important possibilities.
Possibly.
I will not be that very fond of making a drug induced because it is very unlikely the patient to continue the same drug to continue to have the same problem. Usually, when a person stops, within 90 days, the jaundice settles down or the patient goes into some complication. But to continue to have jaundice, that to cholestatic for almost 2 years, that drug is very unusual in the absence of a drug injury. We don't have any drug history of the patient other than CAM in between. Among the extrahepatic, okay, primary sclerosing cholangitis, I agree. PBC is very unlikely. IgG for rare disease and not common in this age. Autoimmune with overlap. An overlap syndrome because age is young. Which is not typical of other cholangitis of autoimmune nature. So, autoimmune overlap is very strong possibilities. Sclerosing cholangitis also cannot be ruled out.
Second possible, yeah. I think in the thing, PSC and autoimmune hepatitis will be the strongest possibilities here in this patient. IgG4 again does not come in this age group, very, very common. Generally, you see in the sixth decade, there are generally 50 years or something like that when you see those patients. Maybe I would put the bet on autoimmune overlap with probably intermittently CAM causing progressive jaundice in this patient.
So I thought of also PFIC and BRIC as one possibility and overlap. Overlap would be more likely. Yeah.
Possibly, correct. Okay. PFIC and BRIC because the fact that he is reserved very well. BRIC is a
reserved,
possibility.
Yeah.
Sometimes it be progressive and you have to introduce rifampicin to bring it down actually.
Interestingly, I'm showing 2 years period, you know, some ultrasound, at least a minimum ultrasound would have been done. And that would have been normal, putting the physician off the track, you know. I said 2 years jaundice, but there's no progression and the patient. So that's why he's comfortable. Ultrasound would have been normal. Liver function would have been just deranged. Otherwise, he's comfortable.
Yes.
So then comes your differentials of a BRIC and PFIC, and that's when they go for an alternative system of medicine. Okay?
Yes.
Okay, we'll just move on. So if you shortlist, the differentials will be, for the examination purpose, will be BRIC, PFIC 3, number 2, number 3 will be autoimmune overlap, being a male patient, will come down on the list. Then I will consider, as Dr. NVK said, primary cavernomatous cholangiopathy, that has to come as a differential. And the last one would be PSC, primary sclerosing cholangitis, okay, on examination.
Patient is conscious, he is oriented to health, place and person. He is moderately built with a BMI of 24. He is deeply equipped, but there was no sandalasma, no vital scores. Nails showed a hyperlipidemia. Skin showed a multiple hyperpigmented papules over the skull, trunk, abdomen, limbs, with multiple scratch marks were seen all over the body. There was no clubbing, lymphadenopathy, or pigmentation.
The significance of xanthelasma, it's surprising, you know, progressive jaundice for 2 years. So when all do you get this xanthelasmas? When all would you look for? Where all would you look for a xanthelasma?
Progressive prostatic conditions like primary cirrhosis, primary cholangitis, became xanthelasma usually around the eyelids. It can also be seen around the neck, below the breast, chest.
Absence is a bit surprising, no? Once again, telling you, there is not a true polystatic in this. There is polystasis, but not to the extent of causing xanthelasma. So that's a bit surprising. Okay. Next slide.
But yes, interesting lesions.
Yeah.
This is the skin lesions which was present as a multiple hyperpigmented patches over the mainly over the cancer extremities of the lower limb, but it was also involving all over the body and the scalp.
Next slide. So what do you think this is?
It's
more due to excoriation? What is
it due to? It was due to excoriations. He was having continuous itching for 2 years.
He comments LVK and BT on the skin lesions and they should destroy.
I don't know. Is it scratch lesions and there's got some xerosis over it and then produce him. The other thing is when somebody was strongly suspecting PSC in this patient, one of the things could be pyoderma gangrenosum. They may be underlying ulcerative colitis, and remember, ulcerative colitis can be absolutely be asymptomatic in these patients.
But this
hyperpigmentation is because of scratching. Many quite a times, so this thing there may be scratching. Following a continuous scratching, there can be zero of the skin, they can ulcerate, all these things can happen.
Next slide.
Nutritional treatment, he has sparse and brittle hair, angular stomatitis present, no biter spots. Mid upper arm circumference was 21 centimeters, waist hip ratio 0.8, but he had some muscle wasting which was shown over the temporal bones and dorsum of the hand. Sarcopenia in 54.2, the frailty score under vulnerable category.
So can you just highlight something about the sarcopenia? Why is it important and how do you do it? The sarcopenia index and the frailty score.
Patient having sarcopenia index of 65.3, it is calculated as a serum creatinine to cystatin C ratio. It has been came under the category of a moderate sarcopenia. As a patient is having a chronic illness for 2 years, we have to assess the nutritional status and muscle density.
So I think for the PG is very important. In any patient with long-standing disease, nutrition assessment is very, very important in all the patients, okay? See that you have your sarcopenia index and the frailty score. Very important for management. Subsequently, especially when you're managing the patients, based on this, the whole management will take place, okay?
Can we go on?
Abdomen examination, inspection, abdomen is flat, full of the right hypochondrium.
Can you just mute when you're not speaking?
Umbilicus is central, inverted, no mass seen around the umbilicus, no discharge, no visible veins were seen in the anterior abdominal wall, flanks or back. There is no visible pulsations or peristalsis. Liver was palpable 2 cm below the right costal margin and 5 cm in mid-sternal line. Liver span was 17 cm. It was firm in consistency with a smooth border, regular margin, non-tender and non-pulsatile. Spleen was not palpable by conventional method, but the crop space was dull, and also by Castor's method also dullness was persisted over the 8th and 9th intercostal space. No free fluid in the abdomen, and perrectal examination was also normal. There is no other mass palpable per abdomen.
So in this particular patient, okay, I think I can unmute when you're talking, please. So one important thing is, you know, the polystatic ring that you should look for these patients. you can get a brownish ring in the eyes and prolonged polystasis. You get a polystatic ring. That is something that you should mention. No polystatic ring. And the other important thing is this bit, you know, you said top space is resonant, is dull. So what's your interpretation?
Pain is not palpable under conventional palpation, but prostate is palpable. So the patient might have a mild splenomegaly also, along with the hepatomegaly.
So you think patients got a splenomegaly?
Splenomegaly.
Okay, LBK, Dr. Burmese.
No, I think it's okay. I think liver is palpable in conjunction with a long-standing cholestasis. Be smooth, regular. Definitely he has got malnourishment. He's got sarcopenia, which is average. Frailty is met. So this is in, I don't think that's being a long-standing cholestasis with malabsorption. Just going. I think in no other comments from my side.
So, Meeti.
Yeah, same thing. Long-standing cholestasis with some features of malabsorption, but no decompensation H. And that's it.
Continue. So, next slide. Next slide.
Other system examination, CNS examination, MMLC 26 out of 30. Motor sensory deep tendon reflexes were normal. There is no areflexia or any ataxia present. Respiratory system and cardiovascular system were also normal.
So at the end of examination, your differentials would be remain the same, or you would like to modify your differentials. What would be the finding in BRIC and PFIC? That's all that we need to know. No, that was your major differential.
Yes, ma'am.
What will be the liver in BRIC and PFIC? Okay, LBK and BT, please. What will be the liver? Liver is enlarged, no?
Yes.
So in PFIC you can get, because that's one condition where it can progress to cirrhosis. In BRIC, most of the times the liver is usually of the normal size.
It's normal size.
Yeah, so if you have a liver enlargement with a top space dullness, now it's more of a hepatosplenomegaly, which puts you more towards an autoimmune process. Maybe BRIC is still a possibility with the sarcopenia, nutritional deficiency, then spleen can also be palpable. And of course, can it be EHPVO? Now, total cavernomas polyneuropathy?
But spleen will be with the duration spleen.
The liver will be normal, that's most important.
But with the, if you are thinking of a PCC to produce so much of jaundice, the spleen would have been definitely large and moderately enlarged.
Yes. So we think we can move on.
EHPVO is very unlikely, and spleen is not palpable. So
if you shortlist to PFIC and maybe at one of the autoimmune processes. How would you like to investigate
the
patient now?
Initial basis.
So two important investigations will give you a quick clue what you're dealing with. Two important investigations.
Liver function test and ultrasound abdomen.
Very good. So you'll ask for liver biochemistry. We don't call it liver function test. Liver biochemistry, and you'll ask for ultrasound. So what do you expect in this patient?
Patient will have a hyperbilirubinemia, possibly conjugated hyperbilirubinemia with the elevated serum alkaline phosphatase will be there. There can be mild elevation of transaminases. Then,
what about gamma GT?
Gamma GT will be also be elevated.
Can gamma GT be normal?
In case of progressive familial intrahepatic cholestasis type 1 and 2, GTT can be normal.
Type 3, it can be elevated.
So therefore, that's important. And ultrasound, what is it that you're looking for?
Ultrasound, we have to look for liver ecotexture, whether there is bile duct, whether there is any extra hepatic obstruction is there or
first
not.
First will be IHBR dilatation. First will be IHBR, and then you trace it downwards up to the CBD. And then also followed with the pancreatic duct.
Pancreatic.
And see whether the gallbladder is normal. No? So first is upstream dilatation, come down to CHG, then the CBD, then the pancreatic duct, and just see whether the two systems are normal. That's the main focus. Agreed, Dr. LVK?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Just move on. Next slide. Yeah. Next slide. Next slide. Yeah.
So hemogram showed anemia hemoglobin was 9.7. ESR was elevated, 100 millimeter per hour. CRP was also positive. Peripheral smear showed dimorphic anemia. All other parameters were normal.
Can you picture my closest now?
Hi. In history, patient was not having any fever for a long time or any other history of cough or diarrhea history, nothing is there, ma'am. So
raised ESR just tells you there's some chronic problem. Chronic inflammatory process. No? That's all that you tell. Or a chronic infection. That's also possible.
Yes, ma'am.
That's also possible. Okay, next slide.
Sugar fasting was 110, urea creatinine was normal, HbA1c with a normal limit, PTNR was slightly elevated, 1.5, serum sodium and potassium were normal, thyroid function was also within normal.
It's right.
So the PTNR is prolonged here.
Yes.
Comment on the raised PTNR.
As patient was having chronic cholestatic disease, patient might have fat-soluble vitamin K deficiency leading to the elevated PTA.
Yeah, you can explain on that. So it's not surprising. And it gets corrected with the vitamin K.
Vitamin K and you get corrected.
Correct.
So simple test.
Yes, so corrected.
LFT, please.
Liver biochemistry showed that total bilirubin 4.9, conjugated 2.5, unconjugated 2.4, serum ALP is 589 per liter, serum GGT 41, serum SGOT 82, OPPD 64, total protein 8.3, albumin 2.6, and globulin 5.6. Urine routine examination showing positive for bile salt and bile proteins.
The point here is somebody going on for 2 years jaundice and he has cracked so much to produce ulcers, the bilirubin seems to be a little low, isn't it? 0.9, number one. Surprisingly, gamma GT is 31.16. And you have an AG reversal with high globulins. So high globulins, AG reversal, very unlikely in BRIC or in PFIC. So that's only a little surprising. I would have expected his bilirubin to be about 18, 19 or 20. It generally what happens, goes up and then stabilizes because of your cholangiovenous reflux. After some time, in cholestatic, the bilirubin does not go up. It just stabilizes only because of the cholangiovenous reflux.
I was also thinking if there's a problem with the export protein, then the bilirubin may not rise so much compared to the ALPFOS, where there's more of a canalic flow cholestasis. And bile salt is the one that causes severe pruritus. So maybe it is one of the export proteins that is one of those mutations which is causing not much of a rise in the bilirubin. It's allowing it to pass. And OTPT is also near normal. You know, you're not getting much of an elevation, very marginal elevation with ALPFOS elevation. And gamma GT is also normal, which means there could be a problem of a mutated type of a mutation where there's an export protein defect. Okay, that one possibility you have to. So please read about those export protein defects. Okay, BSCP protein, BSCP defect, MDR3, MRP3, all those defects.
Yeah, MDR4.
Yeah.
ABC.
Yeah. And it's all. Is it possible that he has an overlying Dubin-Johnson? That's also possible, no? Suppose he has an underlying Dubin-Johnson, then that can explain this 5 milligram. Elevation and bile pigment will be positive. It will be cholestatic. Only the pruritus is not a feature of Dubin-Johnson. No.
Dubin-Johnson.
And ALPFOS
will be normal. ALP is also not very.
ALPFOS will be normal. So these are the ways we will discuss.
No albumin.
Yeah, and now of course it's gone in for a low albumin. But you know when they discuss about this bilirubin and conjugation, they just take off from here. Can it be Dubin-Johnson? Okay. But the symptoms are not like Dubin-Johnson. All right. Next slide.
specific test, 24 hydroxy vitamin D was low, 13.6. Vitamin BTL was normal. Serum homocysteine was normal. Upper lipoproteins were normal. Serum ceruloplasmin, copper, 24-hour urinary copper were normal. Serum ferritin, iron, proton binding capacity, and personal saturation, transferrin saturation were also normal.
LVK, would BTL, LVK, would you ask for all these tests in this patient? That's the question.
Not really. Not really.
Yeah.
Ask because this is more of a cholestatic disease. You would expect the vitamin D and B12. I would not have asked for. Is it all done as a part of a package of tests? I don't know. But I don't think I would have asked for these tests. Okay?
Yeah,
LKM1 negative. Serum alkaline alpha fetal protein is normal. Serum CA99 normal. CEA is also normal.
Would you consider these investigations in this patient?
Unless I see do an ultrasound. I do an ultrasound. It's a mass lesion. Then you consider it. But I don't think we should routinely do these. I think you should go to the ultrasound. Okay. The significant is hyperglobulinemia with a positive ANA. We were all thinking of an autoimmune hepatitis with an overlap. I think that's
the way forward. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Can we go on?
Next slide.
This was actually done after ultrasound.
So what was ultrasound report?
Ultrasound was showing hepatosplenomegaly with dilated portal vein with a dilated IOSPRD was present.
So there was dilated intrahepatic bile radical and common bile duct. Dilated portal vein branches and hepatosplenomegaly. Okay.
So what's the interpretation now?
Patient is having
portal hypertension.
There's
an elevated portal hypertension and there's something which is causing an obstruction.
Obstruction.
To the biliary system. No? There's obstruction to the biliary system. And with a positive IgG. And rise in ANA being positive and high globulin. So what do you think now it is possible?
Autoimmune.
Now it will be autoimmune cholangiopathy. That will come as your
cholangiopathy is one possibility. We don't know. We might have to go for a higher imaging because there was some dilated IHBR. So we need to look for how is the CBD, is it really dilated? Are there strictures or something? And there is IgG4 is gross. IgG is grossly elevated.
Yes, sir.
IgG4 is also elevated. But look at IgG. It's something like 3,000 something.
That's and ANA positive.
It's
not positive. A common feature of autoimmune cholangiopathy.
Dr. Varghese just mentioned that you don't have an upstream dilatation. No? He was mentioning more of a sclerosing type. More of a sclerosing,
no
upstream dilatation. So once there's upstream dilatation, I think you should be
really
careful in your diagnosis, not to
miss it, just
the
pathology. So you should, now, if there's an upstream dilatation with this, you need to really rule out a mass lesion. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Do you have any other higher imaging on this?
Yes, sir.
We can move on to the MRI. The CT pictures were not good. Okay, next slide. Yeah, describe the findings.
In CT, liver measures 18 centimeters with IHBRD and CBD dilatation. CBD diameter was 7.7 mm, portal vein 15.6 mm, spleen 14 centimeters. Gallbladder and pancreas were normal. No pancreatic duct was not dilated, no ascites and no collateral.
Dr. Varghese, what do you think it is now?
CBD actually mild dilatation, IHBR is there, so that has to be at least at the lower end of CBD, that's what I see. Spleen is slightly enlarged. There is nothing wrong in the pancreas.
There is definitely a portal hypertension. Pancreas, they said, appear also, there is no sausage-shaped pancreas. If you are thinking of an IgG4, MPD, you don't expect to be dilated in IgG4 disease. So there is some evidence of portal hypertension. I think I'll pitch in for a long-standing autoimmune hepatitis overlap or an autoimmune cholangiopathy, which can cause this problem. Okay?
Yeah,
yeah,
it's not typical.
It's not typical at all.
Not very typical. I think MRCP will be a criteria. MRCP, if it shows any thickened bile ducts, do an endoscopic ultrasound to look at the bile duct thickening, as well as very closer look at the endoscopic ultrasound on a pancreas will show you sometimes changes of autoimmune pancreatitis if you are seriously considering IgG4 disease.
So what was the MRCP report?
MRCP report also showed the hepatosplenomegaly with the CVD dilatation.
This CVD is, to me, it doesn't look like an IgG4 disease.
Yes,
this CVD does not look like an IgG4 disease. There may be a small thickening in the lower end of the CVD. Can you see that there's a lower end of the CVD?
Extreme lower end. Maybe.
Thickening, only the thickening. So it may be probably type 1 IgG4. We don't see any sclerosing cholangitis pattern in the IHPR.
Yeah. What type would it be, Varghese?
Hepatol? Hepatol should be type 1 only.
No, sir? Hepatol is type 1.
Type 1. Because if you think that this is a small area where there is a narrowing, that's all. It could be only type 1. But your pancreatic duct looks... usually the pancreas will be beautifully enhanced in IgG4 disease with sausage-shaped pancreas.
IHPR also doesn't seem to be dilated, no?
Yeah, that's not great. It doesn't show any speckle pattern or any stricture beading of the IHPR. That is commonly seen in IgG4.
Okay, next slide.
So, MRCP showed hepatomegaly.
Almost same findings, no? SCG, hepatosplenomegaly, dilated postmenage branches, intrahepatic. I'm not very certain about this intrahepatic biliary radical dilatation. Is it significant?
There's no intrahepatic biliary. I think they may be just be prominent. Piled up in the lower end. That's it. And he has got evidence of portal hypertension because of the dilated portal vein, spleen. An endoscopy was done for him to rule out varices.
Yes, sir. The endoscopy was normal.
There was no varices. Was there a portal gastropathy?
Portal gastropathy, mild portal gastropathy findings for this.
So it looks as if he has gone into a portal hypertension.
Yes, so, that will explain the beta early part of it. Or autoimmune disease.
Yeah, it looks like, it looks more like an autoimmune hepatitis with probably or autoimmune cholangitis.
Diameter is only 7 millimeters. Only mild. Yeah.
Very, very mild this thing. Very mild. The normal is 6 millimeters.
Yeah, 6 millimeters. It is a very mild dilatation of the BPD. IHPRT is questionable. Nothing wrong with the pancreas. So of course it is very difficult to make a diagnosis of autoimmune cholangitis.
Exactly, yeah. I think yesterday also we had a discussion on this, no, diameter. So you have to, when you're mentioning this, you must mention the diameter of the intrahepatic radical as well as the CHD. So this is all marginal dilatation, very marginal.
This is predominantly a cholestatic liver disease.
Cholestatic.
Has got positive ANA, has a high IgG levels, high IgG. So, if you strongly now suspect IgG4 disease, and I think one is endoscopy to rule out varices. The second thing is, as Dr. Varghese said, you could have just gone and taken on a biopsy from the ampulla. And you do for an IgG4 staining in that ampullary tissue.
Yes.
If there are more than 10 for this thing, you hit the diagnosis. But in IgG4 disease, I'm not very sure, Dr. Varghese, I understand to correct. How many of them progress to portal hypertension? And second, most of the IgG4 disease has 90 to 95% will have associated pancreatic disease. They'll have sausage-shaped pancreas. They have associated type 1 autoimmune pancreatitis. They will have a very thin this thing. So that enhancement or hypo, that's a thing, is not seen either in the CT or in the MRI. So the next impression would have been to do an endoscopy, took an ampullary biopsy and ask for thing. The next thing is to document autoimmune hepatitis overlap let's do a liver biopsy.
Next slide. Move on to the next slide. Yeah, I think you proceeded with the liver biopsy.
Yes.
But I was just thinking ampullary biopsy, I think that's one learning point. You have just taken that and checked because that's a simple test. Okay. You can move on to the next slide and tell us the findings. Move on to the next slide.
Hepatocytes showed loss of hepatocytes with areas of bridging fibrosis. Sinusoids showed capsule prominence. Central vein were normal. Portal tract showed expansion with the numerous lymphoplasmacytic infiltration and marked fibrosis with portal tracts.
So there is a ocular fibrosis. There is a portal fibrosis which will tell you about the presence of portal hypertension.
Yes.
That means this patient has got a long-standing cholestatic, intrahepatic cholestatic disorder, which has now progressed down to
fibrosis.
Whenever you have, so there is a portal-portal bridging, there is fibrosis, there is myofibrosis portal tracts, and there are numerous plasma cells. And remember, even in immune-mediated liver disease, some amount of IgG4 levels you can see in patients with autoimmune hepatitis. It's not that. In IgG4 disease, you need to have that, as Dr. Varghese said, that he saw involvement of the extra-hepatic involvement, extra-biliary involvement has to be seen. So this, to me, looks more like an autoimmune hepatitis. Okay? Plus, minus, because the thickening of the thing was there, probably an overlap. The thickening could be an autoimmune cholangiopathy, or it could be a putative PSC. There is something called as putative PSC, where you can only get thickening of the things, which is very early forms of PSC. Of course, the only thing to say is IgG4 is that your IgG4 levels are they are broadly elevated, but at the same time, your IgG levels are grossly elevated, 3000. So I would pitch in probably it is an autoimmune hepatitis with a possible overlap. Because look at there is loss of hepatocyte. You don't lose hepatocytes in a pure biliary or IgG4 sclerosis. There are a lot of hepatocytes. There are apoptosis of hepatocytes. There's cholestasis. There are inflammatory cells. There are plasma cells. All these things. So I would mention probably an autoimmune hepatitis with an overlap and probably now progress to a stage of fibrosis.
I was even thinking, you remember the case that you presented, portal vein fibrosis? I'm just thinking, can it be a part of like a non-cirrhotic intrahepatic portal hypertension, a component there? And portal fibrosis is so dense, no, in this patient?
Yeah, very dense.
Very dense, very dense.
You have, despite that, you still have an active disease going on because you can see so much of lymphocytes going on into this and the plasma.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm. So what a learning point. Next slide. Next slide.
Right here.
Next slide.
So there is a significant bile duct proliferation. There is a you will have positive bile ducts whenever there is cholestasis. So obviously there is some overlap. And have they documented IgG4 in the liver?
Yes, sir. IgG4 positive plasma cells. More than 10 per hypercube.
Was it there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can just show that histology slide. I think that showed the plasma cells, no? Did it show
yes,
that?
Yes, sir. The immunohistochemistry slide is not available, ma'am.
Okay, it's not available. Okay. So the final diagnosis was IgG4 related sclerosing cholangitis. But I think in the exam, I think it should be more of an autoimmune hepatitis with overlap.
Yeah. More of an autoimmune, very difficult to say. Age is against IgG4 disease, and the fact that the globulins are so much elevated, ANA2+ positive. Remember, majority of these autoimmune liver diseases, you can have an IgG4 positive plasma cells. If you have an ampullary biopsy and say that biopsy showed IgG4, then we would shift around. This thing. There are no other features of IgG4 imaging. I think Varghese, sir, you like explained. There's no other features to say that there's an IgG4 disease on your image. What do you say, Varghese, sir?
Yeah, this patient definitely has autoimmune hepatitis with a cholestatic overlap. what that cholestatic overlap, we have IgG for elevation and probably plasma cells if there present on liver biopsy, we will say. But here again, without other organ involvement, to diagnose the solitary IgG cholangitis is
very
really wrong. That's what I think. It has to be an overlap.
Okay.
Have we started treating him?
Yes, sir. We started him on steroids, sir, and he responded well.
He has moved on to fibrosis. I think autoimmune hepatitis is much more commoner to have a fibrosis. He has moved on to fibrosis.
Yeah. Just move on the slides. Move on to the he's on steroid,
20
milligram. How is he now?
He has clinically improved, ma'am. His fluoride is reduced and also his bilirubin values are also coming down.
Okay. So what are the learning points in this case, Dr. LBK? You can just summarize and we can
continue. I think this is a very well worked up case of cholestatic liver disease. I think my priority would have been long-standing cholestasis. In the absence of a typical imaging of IgG4 disease, I would pitch in for autoimmune hepatitis. I feel the biopsy is also more towards autoimmune because of hepatocyte loss, lymphoplasmas infiltrate, plasma cells, portal-to-portal bridging, interface hepatitis, as well as bile duct involvement. So there could be an overlap. And the fact that ANA2+ is positive, both will respond to steroids, but I think in this case, you have a difference of opinion. What we in IgG4 disease, you give steroids at 3 months and keep maintaining at 2.5 milligrams for 2 years, which is the Japanese criteria, or you may have to add some other immunomodulator. Autoimmune hepatitis, I would treat this as an autoimmune hepatitis, and probably once I dropped to 10 milligrams, I would have used an immunomodulator. That could have been azathioprine or mycophenolate or 6-MP. I think this is what I would have done for him. I would not so easily stop steroids on him because he's gone on for 2 years. And remember, he has developed a portal fibrosis, bridging fibrosis. So you need to keep him on a longer type of drug. And probably I would use azathioprine or 6-mecoparin on this patient. Okay?
Yeah. Thank you, LBK. LBK, would like to summarize? Thank you.
I think it's a very interesting case, but a little bit tough to make the correct diagnosis. It's definitely an overlap, and luckily this overlap is a combination where we can give steroids for both. There are certain situations where we cannot give because we have a combination of sclerosing cholangitis with autoimmune or a PBC with autoimmune. The treatment options are different. But in this case, for autoimmune hepatitis plus autoimmune cholangiopathy, the treatment is fairly same. So, in fact, all parameters should improve with treatment. And autoimmune disease is one condition where that improved dramatically to steroids, especially autoimmune cholangitis.